In today's problem, we have a triangle. Then we will inscribe a half circle into this triangle and we will tilt this half circle so that it's splitting the left and the right side of the triangle into segments with the length of 4 and 1 and 3 and 2 as shown in the sketch. The question is, can we somehow calculate the shaded area of this red half circle? If you want to try this interesting problem for yourself, you can pause the video right now and then come back and check the solution. Alright, so let's solve this one. So first, we're going to start by labeling the vertices of our triangle as A, B, and C. Then we will label the center of our half circle as O, and we will label the intersection point between this half circle and the left and the right side of the triangle as D and E. Now, from the point D, we will pull a line that is perpendicular to the base of our triangle, and we will label this intersection as P. We will do the same for the point E, and we will label this new intersection as Q. Now you can notice that we have formed two right triangles, APD and QBE. But before we continue, you probably already noticed that the sides AC and CB are congruent since they have the same length of 5. So this means that our triangle ABC is actually an isosceles triangle. So that will lead us to conclude that the angles at the point B and point A must be congruent as well. So this means that our blue and green triangle have two congruent angles, which in fact means that those two triangles are actually similar triangles. Now let's label the legs of our blue triangle as X and Y. Since the hypotenuse of the green triangle is twice as big as the hypotenuse of blue triangle, and those two triangles are similar, this means that the legs of the green triangle are twice as big as the legs of the blue triangle. And we will substitute those values into our sketch. Now let's clear the image a little bit, and let's focus on the line DE. This line is the diameter of our half circle. So this means that the line DO and OE represent the radius of this half circle, and they have the same length. Now, let's pull another radius from the point O to the intersection point between the base of our triangle and the arc of our half circle. This radius will be perpendicular to the base of the triangle. But how can we know this for sure? Well, we know this by using the tangent of a circle theorem, which states that if we have a tangent to a circle and we pull a radius to the tangency point, this radius will always be perpendicular to the tangent line. So we're just using this in our case here, since the line AB represents the tangent of our half circle. Now, with this in mind, we can conclude that the lines QE and DP are all parallel to our constructed radius, because all those lines are perpendicular to the base of our big triangle. So, this means that the quadrilateral PQED is actually trapezium. Now, we can use one really interesting property of a trapezium that states that in any trapezium, you can calculate its middle line or medium of the trapezium as the half of the sum of the bases of trapezium. So if we take a look at our purple trapezium, you can notice that the vertical radius is actually a midline or the medium of our purple trapezium. So we can calculate this radius as the half of the sum of the bases of 2x and x. And we will get that this radius is equal to 3x over 2. Furthermore, we can find the length of the line DE. This is the diameter of our half circle, so it would be equal to 2 times of the radius. If we substitute our value, we can easily get that the line DE has the length of 3x. Now, Let's substitute this value of 3x for the line DE, and let's save our value of radius for later. Now, from this point on, we actually have two options that we can take to find our solution. The difference between those two options is that one uses trigonometry and other doesn't. So, in this video, I will show you both options from which we can continue from this point on. First, let's try the option of not using trigonometry to find a solution. We will start by pulling the horizontal line from the point D. This line will actually be parallel to our horizontal line AB. So this means that it will be perpendicular to the line EQ. Now, let us label our new intersections as F and G. Now, if we take a look at the lines EQ and DP, you can see that we can easily calculate the length of the line EF, since the line EF will be equal to the difference between the lengths of those two lines. So, if we substitute our values, we will get that the line EF must have the length of X. Then, let's notice this newly formed right triangle DFE. We can use the Pythagorean theorem on this one, and we can say that the hypotenuse DE squared must be equal to the leg DF squared plus the leg EF squared. So, we can substitute our values and work through this to finally get that DF squared is equal to 8x squared, which means that the line DF must have the length of x square root of 8. Then, let's notice our triangle APD and the triangle FGE. Both of those triangles are right triangles, and since the line FG is parallel to the line AP, we know that the angles at the point A and the point G must be congruent. So this means that those two triangles are similar, but we can also notice that the leg of these two triangles has the same value of x, which by the angle-side angle theorem means that those two triangles are actually congruent. So from this, we can easily say that the length of the line FG must also have the value of y. Alright, so now with all those values, we will first take a look at the triangle DGC. This triangle will have the side of 4 and the base of x square root of 8 plus y. Then, if we notice the line DF and slide it downward, you can notice that the line PQ will also have the length of x square root of 8. So, if you take a look at our big isosceles triangle ABC, you will notice that this triangle has the side with the length 5 and the base with the length x square root of 8 plus 3y. Now, since the lines DG and AB are parallel, this means that those two triangles are similar. So, we can use the rule of similarity and say that the relation between their sides must be identical. Now, we will just cross-multiply our new equation and get the following. Then, we will continue by simplifying and finally get that 7y is equal to x square root of 8, which means that y has the value of x square root of 8 over 7. Alright, so now let's try to find another relation between x and y. And we can find this relation in the blue triangle APD. This is a right triangle, so Pythagorean theorem applies, which means that x square plus y square must be equal to 1 square. Now we will substitute the value of y and get the following. Here we will put everything to the square, and then we will lose the fractions by multiplying each term with 49 and get the following. From here, we can say that 57x squared is equal to 49, which means that x squared has the value of 49 over 57. Alright, so now finally, let's try to find the area of our half circle. This area will be equal to r squared pi over 2, or you can say pi r squared over 2. It's basically the same. So now we will substitute the value of r and get the following. If we get everything to the square and work through the double fractions, you can simplify this as 9 over 8 x squared pi. But we already have the value of x squared, so we are just going to substitute this value in and get the following. Here we can do a little bit of simplification and finally get that our red shaded area is equal to 147 over 152 pi, which really nicely approximates to 3 squared units, and this is our solution. Alright, but what about the second option? What if we took this really awesome path of trigonometry? Well, if you do this, we will again start by looking at our triangles APD and QBE. We already proven that those two triangles are similar, so now we are just going to label the acute angle at the point E as theta, which means that the angle at the point B must be 90 degree minus theta, since this is the right triangle. Since the triangle APD is similar, the same angles will apply. Now, let's try to find the angle at the point C. We know that the sum of all angles in the triangle must be 180 degrees. So, if we substitute the values for the angles at the point A and B, we will get the following. Now, we can do some simplification and get that the angle at the point C must have the value of 2 theta. Then, we can use trigonometry on our blue triangle QBE. We can say that the cosine of theta is equal to the 2x over 2. So this means that cosine of theta must have the value of x. Alright, so now we can find the value of x by using the triangle DEC and the law of cosines. Just to remind you, the law of cosine states that the square of any side is equal to the sum of the squares of the other two sides minus 2 times the product of the other two sides times the cosine of the angle which is opposite to our wanted side. So we can use this on our green triangle. We can say that the side 3x square is equal to the side 3 square plus 4 square minus 2 times the product of those two sides times the cosine of the angle 2 theta, which is opposite to the side of 3x. Now we can simplify this and get that 9x square is equal to 25 minus 24 cosine of 2 theta. But we do not know the value of cosine of 2 theta. So we will use the formula for the cosine of double angle. In trigonometry, this formula will look something like this. Now let's also remind ourselves that sine square theta plus cosine square theta is always equal to 1 in trigonometry. So this means that we can substitute the value of sine square theta for 1 minus cosine square theta. Now we can simplify this and get the following. But here you can notice that we already have the value of cosine theta, which is equal to x, so we can just substitute this value and get that cosine of 2 theta is actually equal to 2x squared minus 1, and we can substitute this value into our previous equation. If we do this, we will get the following. Now we can simplify this even more and finally get that 57x squared is equal to 49, which means that x squared is equal to 49 over 57, and this is again our value for x squared. Now from here we can again find the area of our semicircle as the r squared pi over 2. We will just follow the same steps as before to simplify this. Then we will substitute again the value of x squared to get the following, do some basic simplification, and finally get that our area is 147 over 152 pi, which of course again approximates to 3 squared units, and again we have our solution. Well, I really hope you enjoyed this challenging geometric problem. If you did, please leave a like and subscribe to the channel for more content. Of course, if you found another way or another option to find the solution, please write it down in the comment section below. And again, until next time, see you all and take care.